تبسم 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 تبسم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه وعلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين. قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. وقال صلى الله عليه وآله وأصحابه وسلم اغتنم خمس قبل خمس: شبابك قبل هرمك، وصحتك قبل سقمك، وفراغك قبل شغلك، وغناك قبل فقرك، وحياتك قبل موتك. أو كما قال صدقت يا رسول الله. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful, all praise is due to our creator, our cherisher, our nourisher and our sustainer. We bear witness there's none worthy of worship but Allah. We bear witness we believe in all the prophets who came in the great line of divine, and we bear witness the Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa ashabihi wa sallam is the final of all the emissaries of Allah. Respected ulama, scholars, teachers, educators, students, elders, brothers and sisters, I greet you with the Islamic universal greeting of peace. May the peace, the mercy and the blessings of Allah be upon each and everyone present here in this beautiful house of Allah on this auspicious time of Jumu'ah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. My theme for today was going to be about fasad and about corruption. And this was in lieu of the Panama Papers that have been leaked and the attempted indictment on the president of this country and the whole notion of facade and corruption, specifically regarding leadership. But we had a tremendous tragedy as an entire family virtually was wiped out in an accident. And two of our students passed away. Two of them have survived, and they lost both their parents in that accident. Also, quite a few of our friends that we know are critically ill. And then upon pondering, I thought we'd rather reflect upon how to deal with the challenges of life. We can always speak about corruption some other time. Life is a roller coaster ride. It's never smooth. It was never meant to be smooth. Life is a test. تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم. Life is a test. And of that test, death is a reality. And as we acknowledge that life is a kaleidoscope of inescapable situations, there is birth, but there's also death. There's health, and there's sickness. There's joy, but also sadness. There's gains at times there are loss. There's laughter, and sometimes there are tears. There's joy, and times there are grief. This is an inescapable reality of life. Whether people are people of faith or otherwise. So we live in a universe of cause and effect, the consequences of which are also inescapable. Fire will burn, disease will affect and infect, time will age the persons, germs will destroy, water will drown. These facts are realities, but they also have moral and social implications. And all of these are realities with which we have to contend and live with. It is how we are able to deal with these realities, how we are able to respond to these realities that determine the course of our lives. A wise person once said, life is not the way it is supposed to be. Life is the way it is. It is how you cope with life that makes a difference. We know from the Quran that inevitable reality, kullu nafsin za'iqatul maut, each and every living thing must taste death. وَيَبَقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, the only thing unchanging, unaffected, immortal is the countenance of Allah. Everything else must eventually fade and everything will sometime come to an end. So there is no avoidance of birth or death. We're not born without permission. Except utilize the individual in the interval between birth and death and to use that time effectively, and that time is the test which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to. We must also realize that Allah did not make this world a permanent place. This is a temporary world and everything here is finite and all things have a time limit. Neither are the good things of the world forever, nor are the bad things eternal. I spoke about the Parvez family, the father Muhammad, his wife Faria, died in the accident. With them, Hadiqa and Shariq, may Allah grant them maghfirah and Jannah. Survived, Kawish and Daim were still students at our school. May Allah grant them patience. One of our dear friends, Dr. Ismail Karjika, extremely ill. I've just received news this morning, one of our ex-students, Muhammad Adam, has been diagnosed with cancer. Another person in the community, well known, the pharmacist Liaqat Razak, also very, very critically ill. So when you reflect upon these realities of life and death and of illness and so on, we realize that these are realities of life, but also they are of a tragic nature. And tragedy in itself carries a tremendous power. Power to cause grief, but also power to cause mourning, power to cause sadness, but at the same time, cause for cooperation, cause for reflection, cause for introspection. But if everyone experiences difficulties, what is the benefit of having faith? You see, faith cannot prevent grief. Your iman cannot prevent grief, but faith can put grief into perspective. Faith provides a philosophy of living that emphasizes the realities of life and the inevitability of death, but all of this in the larger context of a greater existence, that we are part of a temporary world, which is a test from which we eventually have to graduate. That is why in this life, patience is so significant and so strongly emphasized and is a mechanism for coping with trials and tribulations of daily living. Ponder over the Quranic verse, the Surah Baqarah. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Be rest assured that you will be tested. You shall be tested. Prophets were tested. In fact, the Rasul said the prophets were the most tested. You'll be tested with some form of fear, some form of hunger, some loss of property, loss of life, loss of the fruits of your labor, and all of which can be borne by those who have the capacity for patient perseverance. And acknowledge the fact that from Allah we come in everything that we have, and unto Allah is our eventual return. Understand and acknowledge the fact that life, wealth, health, youth, friends, dear ones, all are temporary. The love may be there for a long time, but the relationship. And inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. They and we come from Allah and we are on a journey back. Living in this world is a short phase of our existence and there is an eternity that follows. Our status in this existence, beyond this life, depends by the mercy of Allah on the good that we do. This patient perseverance is so significant that Allah says, Allah, Wallahu yuhibbu sabirin. Allah loves those who patiently persevere. Inna Allaha ma'a sabirin. Allah is with those who patiently persevere. And the Rasul said, As-sabru nisful iman. Patience is half of faith. But for us, As we speak of the death and illness of other people, we too are prone to illness, and we are going to face death. Very often death is not so much a lesson for the dying as for the living. Somebody told me that people read talqeen, you know, when someone dies in Cape Town, they read talqeen or something. And talqeen is actually not so much for the dead person, by the way. It's more to remind those who are there that someday you'll go through this experience. When going to sleep, we do not know, as we said, the companion of the Prophet said, إِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظْرِ الْمَسَاءِ وَإِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظْرِ الصَّبَاحِ وَخُذْ مِنْ صِحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. When you wake up in the morning, there's no guarantee you'll sleep tonight. When you sleep tonight, there's no guarantee you'll wake up in the morning. Take from your life, take from your health, what will benefit your illness. Try to be in the best condition that you can be, so that when you become ill, there are not other compounding factors. Sometimes people have a problem with the heart, but make sure you're not overweight then, because that compounds the illness that you have. Or you're unfit, or you eat immoderately. So take from your health what will benefit you when you do get sick. And take from your life what will benefit you. وَخُذْ مِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. And take from your life what will benefit you when you die. The Sufis have a beautiful saying, or the Arifin if you wish. They say, the human being sacrifices his health in order to gain wealth. We're all so busy living, earning a living, or forget to live. So the Sufis, they say, the human being sacrifices his health in order to gain wealth. Then he sacrifices his wealth to recuperate his health. He is so heedless of the past and so anxious about the future that he does not appreciate the present. The result being that he does not live in the present nor in the future. He lives as if he's never going to die, and then he has died, never having really lived. So value what you have. Sayyidina Ali Karamallahu Wajah said, اعمل لدنياك أنك تعيش أبدا وعمل لآخرتك أنك تموت غدا. Live in this world and work for this world as if you are going to live forever. And prepare for the hereafter as if you will die tomorrow. Work in this world, put your effort as if you are going to be here for always. Do what needs to be done. As the Rasul said, if you have a seed in your hand, even if the trumpet goes of Qiyamah, plant the seed. Do what you can do. So live as if you're going to be here. Work for this world. Work in your efforts in the good things as if you are always going to be here. And prepare for the hereafter as if you're going to die tomorrow. And that put life into perspective. But that means we need to live life to the full. Because what matters is not the length of the life that we live, but the depth of the life we live. And therefore there are people who live more in 20 years than some people live in 80 years. Because they don't just live, they don't just survive, they live the life. Our responsibility as people, and as we look at others, we pray for the well-being and for those who are ill and for the recovery, inshallah, and for the patient perseverance of those who are experiencing hardship and grief, and Jannah and Maghfirah for those who passed away. But we as people need to find more ways in helping and sharing the burdens of others, to make more life more pleasant where we can. We must learn to forgive any hurt or injuries that come our way, and treat others the way we would like to be treated. We must be more cognizant of the fact that small things do matter, that our smiles, our words of encouragement, our expressions, our support, each of these can make a difference to someone, somewhere, who's wrestling with a misfortune or a challenge of life. All our lives are but footnotes on the pages of history. And each and every life is a unique story and contributes to the larger story. Sometimes we enter into each other's lives and become a temporary part of others' lives, and sometimes become a permanent part of each other's stories and part of their legacy. All our lives are part of the story. The important question is, how do we contribute to the larger story? How do we engage? And hence in Islam, this notion of social interaction, of mu'amala, is the largest portion of our law. Social interaction, mu'amala. خَالِطُ النَّاسِ, Sayyidina Ali said, مُخَالَطَةً. إن مُتُّم مَعَهَا بَكُوا عَلَيْكُمْ وَإِنْ عِشْتُمْ حَنُّ إِلَيْكُمْ. Some attribute this to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah knows best. Socialize, interact, live with people in such a way that when you die, they cry for you. And when you're alive, they want to be in your company. We do know that each living thing must taste death. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً ثُمَّ إِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. And through life, each and everyone will somehow be tested with positives and negative realities of existence before we return to Allah for individual accountability. Let us recall the admonition attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, documented in the Musnad of Imam al-Hakim. He said, عِشْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ وَأَحْبِبْ مَا أَحْبَبْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مُفَارَقَ وَعْمَلْ مَا شِئْتْ فَإِنَّكَ مُجْزِئٌ بِهِ. Live as you please, someday you'll die. Love what you love, someday you'll be separated. Act as you wish, do realize that someday you'll be held accountable and paid back. So we realize more than ever that life will come to an end someday. That our existence in this world seems like a brief crack of light between two long periods of darkness. That death is certain, and wherever we are, أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتِ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Wherever you are, death will come and fetch you. The Quran says, أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُمُ. Death will reach you, wherever you are. وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Even if you live in fortified castles, or it will come and fetch you. And therefore, we are reminded of the Rasul's words about the reality of life and how fortunes change and how things evolve. اغتنم خمسة قبل خمسة. Value five things in your life before five other things may come to pass. Value your health before sickness comes. Value your youth before old age comes. Value your free time before you become too occupied. Value what you have before it loses its value, or before you lose it. Value your wealth, whatever you have, and value your life before death comes. And we need to realize and must realize, it's a hadith documented in the Musnad of Ahmad, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. اغتنم خمسة قبل خمس شبابك قبل هرمك وصحتك قبل سقمك. We realize and must realize that every day we live is a day further from our birth. And every breath we breathe is a breath closer to our death. As certain as we are about the occurrence of our death, so uncertain are we about its timing. And we are therefore instructed by the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, إِذَا قُمْتَ فِي صَلَاتِكَ فَصَلِّ صَلَاتَ مُوَدَّعِ. Whenever you do any action, even if you do prayer, pray as if it's your last prayer. Don't assume there'll be another prayer. When you pray now, Jumu'ah, don't assume you'll be here for Asr. Don't assume you'll be here for Asr. When you live with that kind of consciousness, not in negativity, not in morbidness, but the reality of life. Because someday you'll make a prayer, and the next prayer, they'll pray over your body. There will be a day. When that day will be, none of us know. So, إِذَا قُمْتَ فِي صَلَاتِكَ فَصَلِّ صَلَاتَ مُوَدِّعِ. Whenever you pray, pray as if that prayer is your last prayer. And value what we have. Value our health before illness may come. And that's why the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith documented in the Sunan of Imam al-Tirmidhi, said, مَنْ أَصْبَحَ مِنْكُمْ آمِنًا فِي سِرْبِهِ مُعَافًا فِي جَسَدِهِ عِنْدَهُ قُوتَ يَوْمِهِ فَكَأَنَّمَا حِيزَتْ لَهُ الدُّنْيَا بِحَذَافِيرِهَا. Whoever wakes up in the morning, this is about appreciation. Whoever wakes up in the morning, secure in his house, because we are so insecure nowadays. You're not even safe in our homes anymore, with the burglar bars and the guards. How relevant is the hadith of the Rasul 1400 years ago, said somewhere in Medina, and we repeat it in Rondebosch, and lands down 1400 years afterwards. Is more relevant now perhaps than ever before. مَنْ أَصْبَحَ مِنْكُمْ آمِنًا فِي سِرْبِهِ مُعَافًا فِي جَسَدِهِ عِنْدَهُ قُوتَ يَوْمِهِ فَكَأَنَّمَا حِزَّتْ لَهُ الدُّنْيَا بِحَذَافِرِهَا. Whoever wakes up in the morning secure in his bed, secure in his home, healthy in his body, sufficient provision to survive for the day, he has all the treasures of the world without him realizing it. Gratitude is what we must have, because always when we have shukr, we can deal with sabr. And that's why the Rasul said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٌ. Unique is the case of the believer. In any given situation, there's some benefit for him or her. إِذَا أَصَابَتُ سَرَّا شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرُ اللَّهِ وَإِذَا أَصَابَتُ ضَرَّا صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرُ اللَّهِ. When he has something good happening, he is grateful. And that gratefulness and gratitude is good for him. And when he goes through difficulty or hardship, he patiently perseveres, and patience is good for him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant maghfirah and jannah to Muhammad, Faria, Hadiqa, and Sharif. They're students, they're kids here. They're classmates of theirs when they're buried. I met the grandfather at the mosque in Masjid al-Quds on the night of the janazah, and he was speaking to the mufti who made the janazah, and he told the mufti sahab, he told him in Urdu, he said, what can I say, Maulana? I've come to bury my whole family. I come from another country to here, and here I'm burying, they're supposed to bury me, and I'm burying my whole family, my children and my grandchildren. That is the reality of life. Value what you have. Value your family. Value your parents. Value your children. Value what you have. Someday you may or may not have it, or someday you may not be there to appreciate it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant maghfirah and jannah. And patient perseverance for Kavish and Da'in, students in our school, classmates are sitting here. May Allah grant them the capacity to be able to patiently persevere. May Allah grant us to facilitate them to be able to patiently persevere and help them wherever we can. May Allah grant Dr. Ismail Karjika and Muhammad Adam and Liaquat al-Razak and all those who are ill, may Allah grant whatever is best for them. May Allah grant that in the condition they find themselves, may Allah grant them relief. May Allah guide the hands of the surgeons and those who are dealing with them. Let the end result of everything be good. And may Allah forgive us for our shortcomings. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ
وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ.